Good morning, everybody. Okay, this isn't a video I want to do. I'm feeling just not well today, very much not well, but I really wanted to say something, and I really want people to hear it as soon as possible. Okay. I know very few people will have any idea what I'm talking about, and they'll probably cast me off as a nut job or a crackpot. But I am not, okay? This is something important I have to tell you for the very, very few people who will be able to understand it and listen to me. So I beg your patience and your forgiveness for having burdened you with something so unusual. I'm going to inform you of what happens to be the greatest scientific discovery of the century. Yeah, that's me, yours truly. I'm your Huckleberry. You will be among the first to hear of it, so please give me your careful attention, because I really do know what I'm talking about. Let's just start with Isaac Newton and his laws of gravitation. This guy really had it down pat, but he didn't invent gravity, you know, if that's what they told you in school. Gravity was there long before he came along. And he also admitted that he didn't really know the cause of gravity. He just described how it worked. And then I won't score any points by criticizing Einstein, but laughing at Einstein, you know, that's probably kind of rude, but his rubber mats and ball bearings are pretty lame examples of how gravity works, or space-time, and space and time. And we won't use the word space-time, okay? Spare me that. Even Einstein didn't claim to have a real understanding of the cause of gravity. He just also made descriptions and pretty lame examples of how it works. Nobody's ever had a real understanding of the cause of gravity until now, okay? I've got the answer, so pay attention. Grant me a few sober moments and try to absorb the truth of what I'm going to tell you, which won't go into great detail in this video introduction because it's too hard to talk about, but I'll write it down. I'll give you a link to a paper or a couple of papers that will move you in that direction. And the one paper, which is called FOOS Solves Gravity, I'll also include that text to speech as appended to this introduction so you can listen to it as well as view it and read it. Okay. I'm not anybody. I don't have a PhD in physics. I do have a good background in university math and science, very good background. In fact, I slaved 16 hours a day for years, solving the hardest problems and the hardest courses that I could find so that I would be most proficient. And out of that experience, very arduous experience, I developed a proficiency for solving problems and casting them in mathematical terms. So anyway, I wanted you to understand that, and that I'm not entirely stupid, and I've been studying these problems all my life. Even when I wasn't in school, I've taken an interest in what's going on in physics and astrophysics and biology, and I've accomplished a few things. I finished up a proof in statistics that is also on the website. You can look that over if you want to be challenged in high advanced algebra. So anyway, this is only a 4-page paper that I've written called FOOS Solves Gravity, and that's more than sufficient to prove it. I just put a few facts together, doesn't require any math, but like I say, if you don't have a lot of math in your background or in your heart or in your soul, it might escape you. And you definitely have to have a firm grasp of the relationship between clock speed and gravitational strength, or potential, gravitational potential, we call it in school. In other words, if you at a higher elevation and you go to a lower elevation, your clock will slow down. But so will your yardstick shrink simultaneously. And this is something that physicists are not really eager to explain to you. As you leave the Earth, your clock speed goes down, but your yardstick will lengthen out just enough so that there's no change in light frequency at that elevation. Okay, so you understand that's central. That's the crux of the issue right there. If you don't understand that, you'll think that my idea for gravitation is preposterous. But the idea is not preposterous, it's the truth. This is how gravity works. And should I let the cat out of the bag right now? Basically, gravity is not a force that's pulling things down, pulling you down towards it. It isn't an attractive force. It's actually quite the opposite. And it's a force of expansion that is holding you to the surface of the planet. Einstein is the one who brought out the balloon and is blowing it up. He wants you to believe that you're being stretched out on the surface of a balloon. Do you see that? I don't see that. But anyway, give me a chance, okay? I really do have the right answer. And so anyway, what else can I tell you? Listen to the video, read the papers, and excuse me for the title on the one paper, Einstein's Relativity Joke or Swindle. I don't really mean to be rude or disrespect Einstein, but I need to get people's attention. I need to say something that shocked them just a little bit and interest them and challenge them. And so if you have a good handle on college algebra, you can do it. And you can understand exactly what I'm trying to say. And then armed with that, you can read the paper on FOOS solves gravity and you can see what I'm talking about. Okay, so, you know it's pretty crazy to be challenging all the great minds in the world today and in history, but that's what I'm going to do, okay? I got the answer. I'm the one who should get credit for it. So listen to me. All right. I'm going to wish you a good day now. I'm going to sign off, and then I'm going to append that text-to-speech of the paper, FOOS Solves Gravity, and you can listen to that, please. Thank you. Okay, goodbye.
FOOS Solves Gravity 2020, Unified Field to Follow? However certain it is that nobody, especially a nobody like me, could make essential discoveries in physics and be noticed, it is still my sacred duty to do just that. So, first, what credentials qualify me to make such wild claims even if true? I put in 8 years of university science in Montana, ending with a master's in soils from MSU Bozeman in 1979. Having no resources except a GI Bill and a natural talent for insight, I felt obligated to put in at least 16 grueling hours a day most of that time. I took tough courses and honed an ability to set up and efficiently solve the most difficult problems any science student could face. I wasn't able to continue in academics, but strove to preserve and review my notes and keep working on difficult problems. One of those problems involved correcting glaring errors in the logic of Einstein's relativity that slam the door on understanding. Here's where the establishment will stop listening, another conspiracy nut. But if the science of physics is to ever advance toward a unified field, Einstein's balloons and rubber mattresses must be chucked and a clean, simplistic approach taken to the essential relation between clock speed and gravity. For that, I wrote a brief paper years ago that derives the small handful of equations necessary to make all the predictions the relativity boondoggle has been credited with. Knowing that the physics establishment had backed itself into a black hole, I struggled to make sense of it full, knowing that nothing I could contribute would ever get the attention of anybody, and certainly no major discovery was within my own puny reach. It wasn't until September 23, 2020, armed only with my little sword of truth, that the pieces of the big puzzle suddenly moved into place. So, this aging nobody will be the first to announce the true cause of gravity and time in human history. A clear understanding of it requires no additional mathematics. It's a simple concept again, difficult only in the sense that it requires a reversal of the common notion of how gravity works. Gravity is a push, not a pull. The correct understanding should have been arrived at by any competent scientist decades ago, but the obsession with relativity and desire to pacify authority has kept the world in darkness. On occasion, I've written about the absurdity of Einstein's relativity, like others with far better qualifications who were also ignored or rebuffed. The difference is that I focused on the crux of the issue at hand and derived a simple solution. The answers to physical problems probably end up being the same, but many gross errors in reasoning are bypassed. I'm ceaselessly amazed that such absurd concepts put forth by relativists have been so incorporated into human society and repeated for over 100 years. Just give me a chance by purging the dogma of modern physics from your mind and replacing it with the principles given in my paper, Einstein's Relativity, Joke or Swindle. It's a very simple exercise for any math student worth his salt. Then you will be more easily enlightened. Now, once you've got the point of that paper fixed in your mind, you have an accurate grasp of the relation between gravity, clock speed, measurements of length and how light is affected by gravitational fields. The same famous Hafele-Keating experiment used to confirm relativity to the world is recast to instead rebut Einstein's relativity and replace it with a sound and simple approach. Essentially, if you grasp the meaning of these few simple equations, you're ready to appreciate black holes and big bangs. Mix that with the famous redshift and then you, too, are ready to experience the same epiphany I had earlier this week. You will suddenly understand far more than the greatest physicists who ever lived. So, here it is, the real cause of gravity and the real nature of space for the very first time. Enjoy, and tell your friends. Though I had managed to iron out the wrinkles and purge the bull from the crux of relativity way back in the 70s, I was like everyone plagued by a poor grasp of gravitation. Rational concepts and accurate results interest me, not theories. A unified field will never be discovered until the operation of gravity is discovered and fully understood, not that I ever believed I'd be the one to find it. I clung to my own theory of gravitation that had its merits, but it was an old idea using an ether and the establishment had discarded it long ago for what I thought were poor reasons. I used it to explain why clock speed varied with gravitational force and why there could be dark matter. But it didn't have any means of being verified and didn't fit with cosmic redshift. I knew redshift was a gravity effect and had nothing to do with recessional velocity, but was no better off than others explaining how it fit with any model of gravity. It was a long time before I could believe the universe was expanding when even Hubble rejected it being an explanation for his own discovery of redshift. Then a few days ago, while watching a video about expansion of the universe and musing about how it might explain the nature of time and entropy, eureka! Entropy and time are both one-direction vectors. Entropy is a function of time, and since time is clearly a function of gravitational field strength, gravity must also be a one-directional vector. But in our common conception of gravity, it is not that. It is just a fixed force that pulls things towards a center of mass. But if time is a function of gravitational field strength, gravity cannot be what we think. Oh, wait, we all witness that acceleration is a vector that produces gravity. The true nature of gravitational force then began to dawn. It wasn't until I started thinking about the expansion of the universe being responsible for time that the real cause of gravity emerged. The cat is out of the bag now. In the unlikely event anyone ever even reads this, someone else will snatch credit for my discovery. That isn't very likely either because if I jump in too quickly, you'll probably declare the notion preposterous, so once again, clear your mind and ponder the cosmic implications of clock speed and gravitational density as described in my earlier paper. Forget about space-time, balloons, rubber mats, time dilation and all else, Albert. Consider how length and time contract together with gravitational field strength and then consider what happens to the Earth in an expanding universe. Incorporate this with the following facts. Shine a beam of light upwards from the ground. We all know that as the light travels towards outer space it undergoes a redshift as measured by any fixed observer. This is the gravitational redshift, not a Doppler redshift. It is also a fact that the light beam accelerates as it shifts towards the red. This is counter to intuition, right, because objects slow when thrown upwards? Light does the opposite but only as measured by a remote or a fixed observer. If you travel alongside the photon, your clock will run faster to the same degree that the beam accelerates and shifts towards the red, the result being that you do not experience any differences in wavelength. A remote observer will also see that your yardstick lengthens at the same time your clock speeds up. But for you or any local observer, all measurements of time, frequency, and length remain the same. These interdependent facts are crucial to understanding what is really happening and a prerequisite to grasping the nature of gravity. So, think long and hard on this paragraph before proceeding. I'm sorry if I didn't say it right, so read on. It may help to visualize the infamous black hole. We, the great unwashed, hear so often that space and time contract to almost nothing, even to a singularity, inside a black hole. This is the extreme of what I'm talking about. As you approach or enter a black hole, your measurements of distance and time remain the same. The greater the gravitational force, or field density if you wish, the more yardsticks shrink and time contracts, but only as measured from a remote point of view. What is of major importance and not often stressed by physicists, is that distances, clocks, wavelengths all remain fixed in the frame of reference they are in, whether floating in space or surfing in a black hole. The frequency of a laser light remains the same, the density of space and matter, in terms of mass, not weight, remain the same now as they did billions of years ago shortly after the so-called Big Bang. These concepts are critical to my success in imparting to you the correct understanding of gravity, not a theory but the real deal. The physics establishment seems to have a pathetically weak grasp of the implications of their own observations, but you can do better, believe me. So far, the world is fixed on conceptualizing gravity as mass attracting mass, but we're about to see that it is quite the opposite. Are you ready? The truth is, mass does not attract mass but instead pushes it away. Newton's formulas accurately predict what appears to be a force of attraction, but Newton and Einstein both confessed to not having a clue as to what causes gravity. This all changes now. Why does it appear that mass attracts mass when it just ain't so? To answer that, we need to consider the consequences of an expanding universe in our own little corner of space where matter is expanding at more or less the same rate. You must be careful to understand that everywhere is the center of expansion, even the protons and electrons in our own bodies. Were the implications of such facts ever stressed to you by a physicist? Before exploring that issue, understand that the public is fed the proof of an expanding universe being the redshift of galaxies proportional to their distances from us. But we are led to imagine a Doppler shift due to recessional velocity, that since all galaxies are moving away that the wavelength of light is stretched toward the red. But galaxies are not moving away from each other in terms of linear distance. It is rather the space between and within that is expanding. Recall that increased distance is observed from a remote viewpoint, not locally, and neither galaxy can be considered a fixed observer. What we are seeing is the gravitational redshift of light emanating long ago when the universe was much smaller and more dense relative to the here and now. The cosmic redshift between galaxies is the same phenomenon as gravitational redshift where light propagates from a more massive body observed by remote observers where the gravitational field is less. We do know that the universe is expanding rapidly, but this distinction is important. Now it's time to pause and reflect on our expanding universe. They say that some galaxies are receding, meaning space is expanding everywhere, at a rate possibly even exceeding the speed of light, though that should have no meaning. Physicists stress that all points are the center of expansion, but do not talk about how we can observe or measure the expansion of our own bodies or local solar system. If every point in the universe is the center of expansion as physicists rightly claim, then every proton in our body, every cell in our body, is also expanding. It must be. But we don't see that, do we? I'm not blowing up, you're not blowing up. Einstein wants us to think we're getting stretched like a balloon as we roll around the sun on a rubber mat, but I don't see that. Do you see that? Nevertheless, space is thinning out rapidly and every point in our bodies is expanding away from every other point even though we measure the same distance yesterday and tomorrow. Now recall how meter sticks and clocks stretch as gravity diminishes. We don't perceive the reality of our own expansion because meter sticks are growing and clocks are running faster. Everything looks, feels, and measures the same. It's only for observers who are not expanding, or expanding more slowly, that careful measurements might catch us in the act of blowing up. Don't stop there. Protons are expanding and as they do they exert pressure on their neighbors. This we should be very much aware of. We don't measure any changes in distance, but we experience gravity. Consider that the Earth, being the center of a far greater mass than our bodies, consists of a far greater mass than our own, and is expanding with the combined force of trillions of protons. That force pushes against us even from a distance. Or it would be better to say that expanding space overtakes us. Indeed, we are not being pulled towards the Earth, but it is the Earth expanding towards us until it collides with and pushes against us. The more atoms, the faster objects are overtaken and the bigger the push, all else being equal. The more mass in a given space, the faster that space expands to capture nearby objects. A force only appears to be drawing them downward when the opposite is true. The most fundamental property of matter is expansion. Where have you heard that before? Is this blowing your mind? I hope so. If your own volume is expanding at a rate proportional to your mass, even if invisible to yourself, then you can be sure the Earth is expanding a great deal faster. And so the Earth continually catches up to us and pushes against it with a force of 1 g. Gravity being a downward force is only an illusion enforced by the simultaneous contraction of distance and time. Please don't make me say the space-time word. If we want an accurate conception of reality, we must realize that bodies of greater mass expand faster even though they appear to be fixed in size. We know that they are expanding faster because they overtake their neighbors faster and then swallow them up. Should I say it again? We don't observe expansion directly. We see it indirectly as an apparent force of attraction. This is not whimsical theory or some idea of mine. This is the natural consequence of the fact that the universe is expanding and every point in it can be considered the center of expansion. Physicists can't measure the expansion, they infer it from the redshift. So, why can't they properly see that gravity is the result of all points in the universe expanding at different rates depending on the local density of matter? I don't have an answer for that. What I really can't explain is why the universe should be expanding at an accelerating rate if the overall mass it contains remains constant. It could be that as the universe ages and cools, more energy condenses into matter and hence it will expand faster. Don't we assume that all matter is nothing but condensed energy? There's a lot going on that we might understand better if physicists would get off their collective posterior and realize what causes gravity. Not being a physicist, I only roughly grasp why they need to put dark matter out there to explain the gravitational behavior of remote galaxies. Newton's laws work very well up close, but since the logic behind them is contrary to the facts of reality, perhaps we need to find better ones for the behavior of entire galaxies. Indeed, it is not the force of gravity that rules the movement of cosmic bodies, but the rate of expansion within them. An accelerating expansion may be the result of new matter that we can't see. Sorry, I can't help much with that. I'm not a physicist and must leave it to far better minds to explain how acceleration of expansion affects the unusual behavior of gravity on large scales. The question that still begs is what internal force is pushing everything apart. Perhaps there is no such force. It just could be the nature of matter to expand into the void. Of course, there is no void in terms of empty space, but the nature of matter is to expand as if there were one. I didn't want to bust your bubble, but if you want a realistic and scientific conception of the universe and of gravity, you'll have to leave modern physics behind. Gravity is the result of expansion, not any force of attraction. It is the unavoidable consequence of an expanding universe. But what about the unified field? Can we now tie the corrected view of gravity to electromagnetism? I'm not sure what that means, but a new and correct understanding of gravity has to be a big help. Recall that it isn't possible to define length in natural terms except in combined, mutual terms of length, clock speed, and wavelength. Indeed, electromagnetism is a fundamental aspect of any measurement. Only local measurements at any given gravitational potential give the same values. Only in that constant, uniform frame of reference is light speed constant. If a beam of light travels away from a body of mass, it accelerates relative to the fixed observer, a known fact. As it travels towards a body of mass, it shifts toward the blue as measured by a fixed observer. That may not explain what electromagnetism is, but without electromagnetism there can be no spatial definition of reality. The values of electromagnetic waves are fixed in relation to the distances within atoms, which in turn are governed by the rate of expansion of space. Of course, I'll be pondering better explanations for such things between now and the grave, so don't give up.
Let's reflect a little. If the universe were not expanding, there would be no gravity, there would be no time, no mass, and there would be no light. Expansion is a fundamental property of matter and is what drives the cosmic machine. Redshift is only evidence of these facts. Gravity is strictly the result of cosmic inflation, not attractive forces. Modern physicists armed with balloons and trampolines have failed to explain these age-old mysteries, and yet here Mr. Nobody has succeeded.